Hello and welcome, it's Chris here. This is part two of the three-part video series where Flo talks about macOS development versus iOS app development and gives you a basic intro into building macOS apps. So if you missed part one, just go ahead and click right there on that card. Otherwise, I hope you enjoy part two and stay tuned next week for part three. And if you enjoy Flo's teaching style, make sure you check out his YouTube channel, Flo Writes Code. All right, enjoy.
Some aspects of SwiftUI are really different on macOS, so let's dive straight into them. Hey Code Crew, this is Flo. In this second lesson of the macOS mini course, you will learn about what's different in SwiftUI regarding the Mac. You will learn about a few new views that you might not have seen before, and how a few things just behave differently compared to iOS. The lesson is structured in three segments. First of all, I will be talking about window and window sizes. Next, I will be talking about the navigation view and navigation links. And then lastly, I will show you a few new views that you might not have seen before, and also some view modifiers that are just very specific to macOS development. As always, I have already prepared an example project. And in this case, there are just a bunch of different screens for us to look at all of the things that are in this lesson. Let me just run the project and show you how it looks. So it's a single window with a navigation view, a sidebar on the left so we can navigate to other detail views, and then like a basic hello world and a navigation link in the right hand side in the main panel of the navigation view. If you move your mouse to the edge of the window, you will see it can't be resized, and that's because it has a fixed frame. Now, this is a very important concept on macOS because you actually need to specify the frame of your windows. If I just comment out this frame and run the app again, then you will see it already has a different size. And now I can make it really small and also really big. So you will have to, specify a frame for your app. Now, sometimes you want to have a specified size of, for example, a width of 800 points and a height of 500 points. But other times you might also want your user to be able to make it larger. To do that, we can add a second frame with, for example, a max width of infinity and a max height of infinity. Now, let's run this app again, and you will see there might be some issues here. So we can make it as small as possible, and then that's basically our 800 by 500 size. But now we also have the option to make it bigger. In order for all of this to work, you really need to think about your views that are displayed inside of the window. Now, for example, here the navigation view just doesn't fit or fill the entire window. And in order for that to work, you would also need to give it a frame with a max width of infinity and a max height of infinity. I'm not going to dive into too many details regarding the window sizes. I just want you to know that you definitely need to specify them. If you can, choose a fixed size. And if you want to also allow the user to make your app larger, then you should also add a max width and a max height, but you should always, always, always have a minimum size so that the window can't get too small and all of your content is just gone. Next, let's talk about the navigation view and navigation links on the Mac. As I've already told you in the first lesson, the navigation view basically behaves the same way as it would on the iPad. So you always have a sidebar on the left, which the user can drag to make smaller or larger. They can also just completely dismiss it. And then you always have this detail pane on the right hand side, which basically is, shows the view where you have navigated to using the sidebar or just an initial view in your navigation view. Let's have a look at the code for this. So in our app struct, I just have the content view. And then in the content view, there is a navigation view with two children. First of all, a list, that's the sidebar on the left-hand side here. And then also a VStack with a text of hello world and a navigation link with the title navigation link below it. So that's the VStack here on the right-hand side. This will only be shown in the very beginning until the user clicks on one of the navigation links here in the sidebar, and then that view will be shown. But let's stay here for a second, because there's one very, very important concept on macOS. Personally, I hope that this will get changed on WWDC this year, because I just really don't understand their decision here. But if you have a navigation link in the detail panel, and if you click that, the first time you click it, some weird popover opens with your destination view inside of it. But in subsequent clicks, nothing happens. So your navigation on macOS really needs to live in that sidebar over here. Now, for example, we could click on any of these and then the navigation would work. It even supports keyboards, like currently I'm pressing the up and down arrows on my keyboard. All of this happens automatically. But this is just a very important concept that you need to understand. A navigation link in the detail panel might not always and probably will never work on macOS as of SwiftUI version 3. As we are already here on this split view screen, we can get started with the first new views that you probably have never seen before, because they only exist on macOS. And that's the H split view and the V split view. In your code, you use them the same way as you would use a V stack or an H stack, with the only difference being that the user can actually drag to resize this view. So in this example, I have one H split view with a leading text on the left hand side and a V split view on the right hand side with a top text and a bottom text. So now I can drag to resize the H split view, and then I can also drag to resize the V split view on the right hand side. Let's have a look at the code for this. So as you can see, it's really basic. I already told you it's pretty similar to the V stack and H stack. And yeah, that's basically the case. Just use an H split view instead of an H stack and a V split view instead of a V stack. But as always on macOS, you really need to care about the view's frames. Now in this example, I just gave every view a frame with a max width of infinity and a max height of infinity. Because of that, the background always fills the entire left section, or in this V split view, the entire up and bottom section. Now, this is really important. You will have weird behavior in your app if you don't specify infinite frames. For example, the user could drag around this H split view, and then parts of the left hand side will just be empty and your view will stay the same size. So you really need to pay attention to give your view the correct max width and max height if you want to use a split view. Next up are two very interesting approaches that are not 100% specific to macOS, but they just feel at home at macOS compared to iOS. And those are the ways to interact with the file system. So oftentimes you might want your user to open an image file or a text file or anything alike. And there are basically two different options on the Mac for the user to do that. The first one is to use an NS panel, which is an AppKit API. Or the second option would be using a view modifier like file importer or file exporter. Now, in this example, I've implemented both versions. First of all, I have the NS open panel, which gets created programmatically when I click this button. And then secondly, I have the view modifier file importer, which gets presented when I click this button. Let me show both of them to you so you can have a look at how they compare. Okay, so first of all, the NS open panel. It just opens this file dialog here that you have probably seen 1,000 times before. You can select files and yada, 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 and then in the end click open or cancel. There's basically the same API for an NS save panel as well if you want to save a new file. And then the file importer, basically the exact same thing, except for you cannot drag around this file importer, whereas you can drag around an NS open panel. Okay, enough theory. Let's have a look at the code, how both of them are implemented. Okay, so as you've already seen, we have two buttons, one for the NS open panel, one for the file importer. Let's go over the NS open panel first, because that's the old AppKit API. You probably won't use this in your code, but there are some cases where you might prefer the open panel over the file importer. For example, when you're using MVVM and you want to show the panel from your view model, then you can't just use a view modifier like the file importer for that. It might be easier in some cases to just use the NS open panel. To do that, you create an open panel. You can set its different properties like the title or the allowed content type. So the types of files that your user can choose and open through this panel. In our case, the user can only open text files. And then there is a very weird API here that AppKit devs might know, but SwiftUI devs probably have never seen this. This all happens on the main thread. So it blocks your entire app while the NS open panel is running. And in order to present a panel, you just say panel.runModal. This call will block the main thread and it will return once the user has either opened a file or selected and opened a file or pressed the cancel button. When they have opened a file, it will return the enum case OK, which is what this check here checks for. So if we run the panel, we present it to the user, and the user has selected a file, then this code will get executed. Now, what the NS open panel gives you back is a property called URLs, which is just an array of URLs, local file URLs, of course, not web URLs. And then you can just do whatever you want with them. Of course, now you could use these URLs to read the data into a string or into a data object or into an image or whatever it is that you're doing. This is just the API to do that. Then the file importer actually is pretty similar. So it's just a view modifier. And as always with SwiftUI view modifiers, they have an isPresented property, which is just a binding to a Boolean state variable in this case, could also live in your view model via a publish property. Once that value is true, then the file importer will get presented. We once again have the allowed content types array here, so the user can only select text files. And then I've also set allows multiple selection to true, so the user can select multiple files at the same time. In this case, we get back a result enum, which can either be of case success, and then it contains the URLs of the files that the user have selected, or it has the case failure, and then it contains a simple error, which you can then handle on your side. One important thing that I also want to mention here is that macOS apps live in a sandbox environment and you always have to pay attention to which sandbox entitlements your app needs. So in this case, we want to open user selected files. So you will have to set that entitlement in your project, select your target, signing and capabilities, and then in your app sandbox section here, under user selected file, read only would be sufficient in this case. If you also want to save or edit the files, you of course need to select read and write. As you've probably already noticed, the sidebar here in the navigation view window has a very subtle blur effect and blurs everything that happens behind the window. So if I move it around here, then you will see its color change slightly depending on what's behind it. This is done automatically if you have a navigation view with a sidebar, but if you also want to have it in any other view, like I have in this case, then there is no native SwiftUI solution for that. But I think that this is something that you actually want to do pretty often. So I just want to quickly show you how that is done as well. Under the hood, this uses an NS Visual Effect View, which is an AppKit API. And to use this AppKit API, you have to do basically the same approach than you would have for a UIKit API on iOS. So you create a NS view representable, like a UI view representable. You make your NS view, and then you can also update your NS view. For this visual effect view, there is nothing to update, so that's just an empty function here. And to make this view, we just create an NS visual effect view, and then we can set the blending mode to behind window. And this way, the colors that are behind this app's window will be blended and blurred into the background. And then you can just set this background effect, is what I call the view representable, as the background of any other view, just like that. I think this is a nice little touch that makes your macOS apps feel at home at macOS. Now there's two more very small modifiers that are also at home on macOS that you probably want to add to basically every input element of your Swift UI app. And the first one is the help modifier, which displays a little tooltip when the user hovers over a view. So in this case, when the user hovers over the Hello World text view, it displays this is a help pop-up. In code, this is just a single line. Just add the help modifier to your view and then insert a string. Now this is a localized string. So if your app is localized and supports different languages, then this will get automatically translated as well. And next up, there are also keyboard shortcuts, which are very vital on macOS because people usually use their Mac because they want to be faster than, for example, on their iPad or iPhone. And keyboard shortcuts are just one way to make the experience faster and more fluid. Now, in this case, I have a simple button that you can click to change the foreground color or actually toggle between green and blue. And when I click Command, Shift, and U, the button action is also fired. Let's have a look at how that's implemented. Also very simple. So I just have this button here with a regular action that just changes its own foreground color, which is stored in a variable. This is actually not really important. The important part is this keyboard shortcut modifier here. You can apply that to any button, for example, and then when the button representing the letter U is pressed together with the modifiers that are specified in the second half of this view modifier. Now in this case, that would be Command and Shift together with U. Then the action of the button will also be fired. Something that you should keep in mind for your pro users to have a very nice and fluid workflow. That's already it with this lesson. We have covered window sizes, how the navigation view and navigation links behave on macOS, how you can have resizable views via the H-split view and V-split view, how you can open and save files on macOS via either the NS Open panel or the File Importer View modifier. We have discussed how to add that blur background view, how to add a little tooltip when hovering over a view, and how to add a keyboard shortcut to a Swift UI button.